Welcome to this week's edition of Mainely Motorsports, and this, along with 250 coverage and my Snowball Derby coverage, is my favorite shows, as we are now talking about the big race that's coming up this weekend, the Oxford 250, and we're blessed to have six drivers, every one of them with a shot to win it. Some of them have won it. And I want to welcome Brian Cruzat from the Double Zero, already got a win on the fast tour. Garrett Hall, who's chasing that championship down to Beech Ridge, but really wants the big one at the Oxford 250. Anybody that's watched this show the last couple of years knows what this guy's done. He only wins Oxford 250. That's all he does is wins Oxford 250s, and that's Travis Benjamin. And then we have Scott Mulkern, who's when we first tried back in the 80s to win this race and still trying. And Kyle Treadwell, you know, the guy that burst on the scene last year as a rookie in the super late model division up there. Now he's second in points, looking for that big payday. And Jeremy Davis, the guy that I nicknamed Podium, because that's all he does every week is finish on the podium. And I want to thank Brandon Paul for coming on board here and helping me out with this. And really, any one of them could win it, right?
Oh, yeah. It's so wide open this year. It's unbelievable. And 25, 30 drivers, I think, have a legitimate chance to win the Oxford 250. I mean, we have a few guys here who have entered the picture recently and really established themselves as contenders. So I'm really looking forward to the Oxford 250 this year. I think it's going to be a spectacular event.
And everybody knows, and everybody talks about it, and every one of these guys has been through, except young Garrett Hall, the draw. Yeah. You know what I mean? What that is, and you know, and how that can almost set your mindset by having a bad draw. You kind of now you really disrupted your day.
Oh yeah, and the draw is so important because of where you're going to start, but also, I mean, who you get in your heat. I mean, that's what a lot of guys talk about. Not only where they're starting, but who they're starting next to. I mean, there's been some guys who started 10th, but maybe they get a weaker heat and they can make their way to the front. So it is really important.
Yeah, you're right. So we're going to take a break, and when we come back, we're going to ask the panel the questions that you guys all want to hear about the 250, what it takes to win it, what it takes to get ready for it, and what it takes to just be a part of it. So we're going to take a break, and we'll be right back here on Mainely Motorsports.
Fast Laps Raceway is Maine's premier slot car facility. 641 Lakes Region Commons Drive in North Windham. Whether you want to try out the rentals or have your own custom car built, Fast Laps Raceway can make a racer out of anyone. Birthday parties at Fast Laps are always a hit. If you have ever wanted a fun, inexpensive way to get involved in the sport of racing, Fast Laps Raceway gives you that chance. Find Fast Laps on Facebook or call 207-229-1575. Fast Laps Raceway. Way.
Not sure what brand tire to buy? Town Fair Tire has them all. Michelin, Goodyear, Firestone, Bridgestone, Pirelli, Toyo, Yokohama, Hankook, and more. No matter what size or brand, Town Fair Tire beats all the competition, even online prices. We'll also do a free front wheel alignment with any tire purchase. Name brand tires. The lowest prices. Free alignment. Nobody beats Town Fair Tire. Nobody.
Name brands at discount prices. Town Fair.
Today's vehicles are equipped with complex safety features, such as anti-lock brakes, seatbelt restraints, and airbag systems. Even collision avoidance systems. Not available in all models. Hi, I'm Sean Moody from Moody's Collision Centers. We don't wish bad luck on anyone, but even with today's technology, we need to keep our eyes on the road and our hands on the wheel.
Moody's Collision Centers, now with 9 locations in Maine.
Mainely Motorsports, brought to you by
Bentley Saloon, Route 1 in Arundel. Stop by and see why me and my friends say, who has more fun than us? We do.
LKQ Corp. Any part, any repair, anywhere. Located on Route 202 in Gorham. Southern Maine Motors, out to be Maine's number one Chrysler Dodge Jeep dealership. Route 1 Saco.
Hey, we're back on Mainely Motorsports, and the first guy with a legitimate shot to win, if you do the numbers, okay? This is your third 250, right?
Yep.
Where'd you finish in the first one?
31st. Yeah.
Okay. Where'd you finish in the second one?
Somewhere right around there.
16. Yep. 31 minus 16 is 15, right?
Yep.
16 minus 15 is what? One.
Gee.
So really, Brian, you know, by looking at the numbers, you know, it's all in place for you to win this race. And after the last showing in August, I mean, you really got the car capable of winning this race.
Yeah. Somehow we unloaded at Oxford there in the spring, and I thought we had a pretty decent shot at it. We we messed some tires up, and we went to Beach Ridge, and the thing, we just hit it, and we've been trying to stay with what we've been doing to it, and I can't complain about it. The thing's been a rocket since. I wish I would have kept a motor in it at Beach Ridge the last race, and this last one, I really didn't think we had the car to win when we were there in the beginning of August here. I thought we were struggling a little bit more than we should have been, and we put some new tires on to get in with the Conti there, and they dropped the green flag, and the thing just took off like it did at Beach Ridge, and we drove right up through there. And, got pretty lucky. I got into one guy watching a bracket drive through the infield, trying to miss everything, and I thought I messed the nose up too bad to win the race, and it stayed together though for the rest of the race.
Garrett, you've raced at Beach Ridge all your life, sitting second in points in the Super Late Model division right now, the Pro Series. But you've really adapted quick to Oxford. I mean, a finish of fifth and a finish of third and two career starts here in a Super Late Model. What is it about Oxford that that you're hitting on right now? What is it that you like so much about that track?
To me, I noticed that it's more of a momentum track, kind of, to Beach Ridge, smoother. You don't have the backstretch wall like you do at Beach Ridge. And the corners don't seem as tight, so, and the just seems so much more faster, I guess. Not so much faster, but it just overall is kind of a different track.
Do you like it more, though? I mean, you grew up at Beach Ridge, but Oxford, are you saying it's growing on you?
For sure, yeah. Depends on how Oxford 250 goes, I guess.
Now, Travis, really, do you know what you're going for? I mean, honestly. I mean, you know you're going for that third win to join Mike, Ralph, and Dave. But to be able to do three in a row against the caliber of competition that's out there, I mean, how often do we think about that?
Yeah, not very often, obviously. I remember back when Ralph did it, and I was in one of those races, and I said to myself, I was the guy who went three Oxford 250s in a row, and now we get the opportunity to do it.
Yeah, no, you're right. And like you said, three in a row, and anything can go wrong in any one of those. You know, last year, you had to go to the Conti. You started 25th. I mean, does that make you nervous to have to come from mid-pack knowing that, you know, it ain't only what you do wrong, it's what all the other guys do wrong that can collect you?
Oh, no question. It's a real tough race, obviously. Qualifying is real, real crucial most of the time. But you look at the race last year, and Richie started way back, we started way back, and it's a long enough race, so you can work your way up through the field, and just everything's got to go right, though, exactly.
Yep.
Scott, you've made 11 career attempts at the Oxford 250. Career best finish of fourth in 2006. One career pass win at Oxford. But we mentioned the draw. You've been around. You've been involved in the draw. How important is that, in your opinion, to come out of there, out of that pit meeting or whoever the draw may be, and have a good starting spot in your heat race?
Well, you guys touched on it earlier. It's real important, but there's nothing you can do about it. I mean, so, and it all depends too on who's in your heat with you. You know, you could get lucky and get into a, you know, you could start 10th and have slower cars in front of you. So it's real important, but there's nothing you can do about it. I used to get pretty keyed up about it, but now I'm like, you know, just hope for the best. So.
Do you draw yourself, or what is your tradition?
Sometimes. I think I have been. I let Chabot, he drew for me last time at Oxford, and we got the pole in the first heat, so, but you never know. I mean, I'm superstitious, but I don't care who draws, really.
Now, Kyle, you know, you're a Saturday night guy. You're in a points battle, you know, racing, you know, Timmy Brackett for the championship. When it comes to this race, though, does that weigh in on the cost that, you know, going to compete in the 250 versus trying to finish the year out and, you know, make sure you have the funding to chase those weekly points?
Yes and no. I mean, Tim's been on a roll all summer long, and we don't really have a legitimate shot at the championship, so the last two or three races we've been pretty much just trying different things, trying to go for the 250, and it's kind of killed our shot at the championship as well because we haven't been running that well. So it all depends. I mean, obviously, money-wise, I just want to come out there with a complete car.
Jeremy, you've made two attempts at the Oxford 250, going for your third. Your first one didn't go so well. You didn't qualify for that race. Last year, you sort of picked up the pace at Oxford. You went there weekly a couple times and really raced there weekly to get your car tuned. how much more confident are you this year going into the 250 than you were last year?
Well, I don't know. This year's been pretty good. I've got a lot more confidence, I think, not only in the car, but in everything we've been doing at all the tracks. I mean, I feel more at home than I ever did before at Oxford, just the way that the track is and figuring it out. But really, I don't know, my car's been really good everywhere.
Did you ever think, I mean, a couple years ago, that you would be entering the Oxford 250 as a favorite to win the race?
No, not really. It wasn't really in my wildest dreams, I guess. I kind of like being the underdog. I like being kind of like Kyle, you know, just a guy that, you know, nobody really knows if he can or he can't, but kind of want to see it happen.
All right, we're going to take a break. When we come back, we'll hear from again the next round of questions.
Race fans, it's finally here. Time for the biggest short track race in the country. It's the 42nd annual AIM Recycling Oxford 250 presented by Kenny Upol. Friday, August 28th through Sunday, August 30th at the legendary Oxford Plains Speedway. Bring the family out for the entire weekend to see the best short trackers in North America. See the Valenti Modifieds in action Saturday night, August 29th, and then Sunday afternoon, August 30th. It's the granddaddy of them all, the 42nd annual Oxford 250. Oxford Plains Speedway is located just off Route 26 in Oxford. For more info, go to oxfordplains.com.
Welcome to Mainely Motorsports.
To order copies of a show, send a check or money order for $15, shipping and handling included, to Mainely Motorsports, 326 Roosevelt Trail, Windham, Maine, 04062. And please add a description of the show.
Looking for something different and exciting to do on Friday night? How about real NASCAR racing at Lee USA Speedway? Featuring the ground-pounding super-fast super-modifieds, the fender-rubbing late model sportsmen, unpredictable hobby stocks, and more. It's great family fun and excitement. Kids under 12 get in free, and there's acres of free and easy parking. Friday nights at Lee USA Speedway, located right on Route 125 in Lee, New Hampshire. Check LeeUSAspeedway.com for more information.
Hi, I'm Johnny Wolf. Since 1972, my family has been selling and servicing vehicles here on Route 25 in Gorham. Today at 21st Century Motors, we offer a great selection of used vehicles at the lowest prices and financing for all credit scores. At Wolf Auto Service, our ASC certified technicians do quality auto repairs and state inspections for just $58.50 per hour. Stop in at our Route 25 Gorham, Maine location today or online at 21stcenturymaine.com.
Okay, Jeremy, since July 4th, you've run 7 races. Take the Beatridge race out. The other 6 races, you had an average finish of 2.16. I mean, you've hit on something, right? You want to share it with the rest of them, or do you just, I mean, that's got to just make you real confident.
Oh, yeah. We, we're really on a roll. I mean, all year's really been really good. I know Beatridge wasn't very good, but we had mechanical problems early that dropped us out. I mean, the car was great. The Dale Shaw race cars have all been really good, and we're all working together. So it's really nice to be on a roll going into the 250 and have, you know, some of my best runs leading up to it. It really, you know, gives a strong indication, I think, of what could happen.
Kyle, you grew up 30 minutes from Oxford in Auburn, and I mean, I'm sure you grew up going to the Oxford 250. Last year, your first attempt at the race, first year in a super late model, you go out and qualify for the race. What was it like when you were standing on the front stretch for driver introductions, realizing that, hey, I just made the Oxford 250?
I was pretty nervous, actually, because I look behind me and I see Travis starting behind me and DJ Shaw and all these top guys. I'm like, oh, I'm going to get run over here very quick. But no, it was an experience, really. I learned a lot, and I'm ready for this year.
When you mentioned the nerves, how quickly did those go away?
It took a solid 100 laps until I settled down and was ready to go. It was really after the pit stop. I was like, hey, now we can just have some fun. And we went a lap down early, and it was just, there's a few big wrecks, and we got through them, and it was fun from there.
Now, Scott, everybody puts in ultimate preparation for this race. You're no different than anybody. But in 2013, power steering failure. Last year, a flat tire. So it doesn't matter what you do. You got those gremlins that can just ruin your day.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I don't like the name.
No, I know.
I had a lot of trouble this year, too. But you know what? You know,
Well, so when you say that,
do it to yourself too, though, sometimes.
Do you think it's an advantage or a disadvantage for a guy like yourself that runs a handful of races, now tries to show up for this race and be competitive?
No, I should be. I mean, I'm Tony's works for me part time, but I mean, he does a good job. But I mean, there's only so much a guy can do. I'm not putting a new rear end in. I'm not gonna have a brand new car there, but we're as prepared as anybody, I think.
Travis, you said, Steve said actually, all you do is win Oxford 250. So going in this year, going in for three in a row, can you leave Oxford Plains Speedway on Sunday, August 30th, being satisfied with anything but a win, or have you been spoiled these past 2 years?
Yeah, you know, my team's talked about that, and it's sad to say, but if we do leave there without a win, I do feel we're going to be disappointed, which we shouldn't be, because, you know, just to win that race is unbelievable. You know, I still have to go downstairs in my house and make sure the trophy's still there, because I don't believe it sometimes. And so yeah, I mean, it's tough. Even, you know, we said that even before the season started, if we don't win this race, we don't win the Remax 250, and we don't win a couple races, it's going to be a disappointing season, which I think anybody would dream to say that. And, you know, I'm just going to have fun with it, do what we can, and if it happens, it happens.
Now, how about you, Gary? Are you a numbers guy? You know, you finished fifth in April, you finished third in August. You know, 5 minus 3 is 2, 2 minus 3, 3 minus 2 is 1, right? I mean, you drove from 26th on the field, you know, with Brian up there the front, and, you know, as fast a car as anybody at the end. So, I mean, what did that do that day in August do for your confidence as you roll into the 250?
You know, obviously it's makes you know they have a good car up to Oxford, and you know anything can happen. But, I mean, going to that race, my main goal is just to qualify. I've never been up there for that race. We're not very experienced with pit crews and changes and stuff like that, but we're going to practice. And just our main goal is to qualify and see what goes on from there. And focus on Beach Churchill's.
Brian, you up until August 2nd, you had struggled at Oxford. It was not one of your best tracks. I mean, you had finishes, I look back, 12th, 14th, 16th, 23rd, 28th. 28th, 31st, and 33rd. You had never recorded a top 10 finish until August 2nd. I mean, how does that feel to be able to run that well knowing the big race that's coming up on August 30th?
Feels pretty good. I mean, if you look at all the reasons for those finishes, we had 90% of it was mechanical. I mean, my first 250, we sat on the outside pole. Got to do my first Mainely interview and, you know, stuff like that. We have had some really good cars that have charged from the back to the front a couple times, and we always get to like lap 100 and I just throw the anchor out the window. You know, I never could get all the way to the end of the race. Always something broke. You know, the next year, the 250, my second 250, we came in, pitted for tires, I dumped the clutch, leaving the bit stall and the rear end, the brackets rip right off the rear end and everything spun upside down, and that was it. I drove it by the wall. We've had fairly decent cars, I just have not been able to get it done. We put everything into it this winter. Driving a Dale Shaw car, it's hard to beat them right now. And, you know, Jeremy's tearing it up with one. I'm doing halfway decent on the flat tracks here. And DJ's been decently consistent all year. So I'm really excited to go into this thing. I think we have a solid shot at it. And we've prepped and maintenance and done a lot of stuff I haven't done past, trying to secure this thing. So,
all right, we're going to take a break. When we come back, we'll hear what they have to say again as the race gets closer and closer and closer.
One company is on a mission to put 1 million people to work each year. Sounds like a big number, doesn't it?
Not to Express employment professionals.
With jobs for CNC programmers and welders, we can find you the best opportunity.
Let us help. We'll open doors for you.
Thank you.
Patman's Redemption and Agency Liquor Store is located at 95 Tanberg Trail in Windham, Maine. With over 400 feet of hard liquor and 15 doors of ice-cold beer and soda, Patman's can handle all of your beverage needs. And if it's wine on your agenda, we have over 300 varieties in stock. Then when the party's over, Patman's can handle all of your main returnables, and we welcome all bottle drives. And if you're late for the race, drop off the bottles and pick up the cash at your convenience.
Hey, this is Patman himself, just letting you know that Patman's is your one-stop shop for all your thirsty needs.
Legendary race car driver Bentley Warren is putting Arundel on the map. When Bentley's Saloon opened in 2004, it was just a little bar room on the side of the road. Today we have a giant saloon with live music, dancing, and great food and drink indoors and out. We're always looking to meet new friends and have a good old time. There's always something exciting going on at Bentley's. That's why we like to say, who has more fun than us?
We do!
Mainely Motorsports, brought to you by
Moody's Collision Centers, now with 7 convenient locations: Gorham, Scarborough, Biddeford, Portland, Sanford, Lewiston, and now South Portland. Visit us at moodyscollision.com.
Scotch Recreation. Whether you're thinking about your first camper or looking to upgrade your current one, Scotch Recreation can help you. Get both our Route 202 Manchester and our Route 4 Turner locations and online at scotchrecreation.com.
New Hampshire Motor Speedway. Join us for our 25th anniversary year.
Ryan, before we took a break, you talked about last year was the pit stop that did you in. I mean, how much do you worry about the pit stop, and do you play the race as it comes to you, or do you go in with a plan?
We've tried to have a plan 2 years in a row, and seems like the green flag drops and everything goes right out the window for us with the pit stop plan. So we've got a couple scenarios we have figured out, I think. I've had everything happen from the air hose flying off the gun to the gun not working to the jack breaking on a pit stop. So we've been working on that a lot. We're actually going to practice this week and everything, and I get some new equipment for the jacks and stuff like that. But I think strategy-wise, you kind of just got to go with how the race plays out. I've personally seen the 250 go 100 different ways, so I think that's the way it's going to end up.
Garrett, you raced the past 300 last year at Beechridge to get some long distance experience, but going into the 250, your first 250, what exactly do you expect, and is there anyone maybe you're leaning on for help or advice to help you with that extended distance race for the first time?
Obviously my spotter, to help him judge me and let me know what if I'm pushing it too much, and my crew, and my crew chief, and my dad. Obviously, he's been to him, and he knows what to do. And just everybody. I mean, I'll just take advice from anybody.
That guy next to you may be able to give you some.
Absolutely.
Nope. No, I'm watching go by me last week.
Now, Travis, compare your first win. I mean, there's nothing like that first one. But compare the differences of what they both felt like, but also what it took to those days to get to victory lane.
Oh, yeah. My career has been a roller coaster ride. We've had real good years and we've had real bad years, you know. And in 2013, I remember going through the heat race and I couldn't even get my seatbelts on because I was so nervous. And, you know, that day is just so stressful that it goes by so fast you don't even get to enjoy it. So after that race, I told myself, you know, in 2014, I'm gonna go to Oxford, enjoy the whole weekend. You know, if it happens, it happens. And last year, that's what I did, and I'll tell you what, I enjoyed it much. You know, I enjoyed it a lot more last year. You know, but it's been great.
What's it like, you know, after? You know, looking at, and I'll never forget, because last year I was on the infield, and I took that walk with your dad from the pit stall to victory lane. You know, and had my run and. Just the emotion that the rest of the team feels. I mean, I know it's good for you, but the rest of the team, the emotion that they feel. And once again, I was looking at the pitches, and there was Buzzy in another victory lane photo.
Oh, yeah, Buzzy, he's been great. He always comes and talks to me. Now that we won a couple. And but, yes, it's great for the family, you know, my son. You know, we look at that first 250 trophy. It's got my name next to Kevin Harvick and Kyle Busch, so he thinks I'm a superstar, you know, and up until we won that race, people had heard of Travis Benz, but not really. You know, we won the championship in 2012, and that really didn't mean much, but when we finally won that race, that's when people kind of took notice.
Scott, Travis mentioned the nerves that go with the Oxford 250, and some others have already talked about it as well. Going into your 12th attempt, have you noticed that you're going in each year maybe a little more relaxed than the last year, just kind of trying to have more fun with it?
Yeah, for sure. Yeah, absolutely. But I, you know, that's, I think that goes along with age. Everything I'm doing now, I try to be a little more relaxed about, so.
You feel like you can tune yourself out, or have you in the past tuned yourself out with so many days of practice, Friday, Saturday,
yeah.
Sunday?
Oh, yeah, for sure. And I'm like, this year is going to be, I'm going to go park the hauler, and I may not go out till Sunday. Well, the motor blew up the last race, so I may go out and just make sure this one's going to run. But I think I'll wait till Sunday to do much. I think my car last race was, it was too loose. I wasn't gonna win the race, but I think I know what I need to do. But I guess that's why I've been doing it so long. You always think I know what to do the next time, and then I'll probably just practice on Sunday. A lot of guys will run every day, and you know, I remember Dave Dion. You couldn't stop him from practicing. He was out there every lap there was, and them guys, and they won what, three of them. So, but I've seen guys not practice and do well too. So.
Yeah. Now, Kyle, you know, obviously sitting second in points, you know, you're watching that first guy at the draw as well, because as soon as he gets in, you've got that provisional. And that's a $1,000 provisional, let's face it, for the Saturday night guys. So how much do you pay attention to the drawers, not only what you, but the guys in front of you in points, how their heat looks, and you know, because you could actually start your heat knowing you're already in.
Yeah, no, it helps. That was the goal going into the season, was to be in a position for a provisional. It definitely makes the weekend a little less stressful. So I'll be praying that Tim makes it in his heat if he goes out before me. That's for sure.
Jeremy, Brian mentioned earlier Dale Shaw race cars. Everybody's talking about how well those cars are running right now. You could work there, so I mean, you get to see it day in and day out. But you also get to work with those guys, Joey and DJ, when you show up to the racetrack. How much does that help you to be able to rely on sort of a team? You're not really a team, but in a way you also are.
Yeah, I mean, we really are. I mean, if any of us need anything or missing parts, stuff breaks, we all help each other out. And it's, I don't know, it's really the only way to do it as far as I'm concerned. We share all the information. I mean, me and Brian pretty much ended up with the same thing last time at Oxford. And his wasn't that good at the beginning of the day, and I didn't practice at all, but mine was good. So, you know, his ended up good at the end of the day when we all pretty much end up at the same thing. So, I don't know, it's really exciting to be part of, something bigger, I guess.
So, you pretty much have a hand on a lot of these cars at the shop and stuff. So, if you can't win it, I'm sure you're kind of hoping one of those guys do, right?
Oh, yeah, definitely. I got my hands in all of them. So, I don't know, Brian's not much of a numbers guy, I can tell you that, because I get to set his up.
Now, Jeremy, you show up, there's no flamboyancy, not the big entourage, not the big fancy hauler, not a car loaded up with sponsors. You just get it done. Talk about the team that helps you. I mean, obviously you're the main guy, but you've got a lot of support there that helps you get it done.
Yeah, it's just really my family, my mom and dad, and my sister Nicole. She'll throw tires on or whatever. My grandfather's there to do whatever. And then my friend Tom, he spots for me. He loves racing. You know, we're just we have a lot of fun, I guess. I don't know how to explain it. We're not into being flashy or showing off or doing anything. We're there to race and have fun, and we have a really good time. I got to thank Gene and G.E. Brown, Gabe, Tiffany. They help us out a lot. You know. Just, I don't know, it takes a lot to be able to run all year like we have been doing, and they help us out.
Kyle, 2 years ago, you were circling Oxford Plains Speedway in an outlaw car on Wednesday and Saturday nights. Did you ever think that it'd be a reality to get into a super late model and have a chance to even qualify for the Oxford 250?
No, absolutely not. I ran outlaws last season in 2013, and the goal after that was to move up to Wildcats at Beech Ridge, which is a pretty competitive class, and that was my dream, was to win a championship there.
And that winter we got a late model and we converted it to a super, and just to be able to qualify and run against these guys here, it's definitely a dream come true.
What was the learning curve like going from a outlaw to a super late model? Was that something, I mean, it took a while for you? I mean, obviously it didn't take too long because you qualified for the Oxford 250 in your first drive, but what was that learning curve, and then who did you sort of lean on to rely on for information?
The biggest learning curve was not to use my fenders like I did. I had the big steel bumper and the steel fenders. It was a lot easier to lean on people, and leaning on people, every week there were different guys that would come down and talk to me in the lineup. Obviously I have Tim, TJ, you know, they were great help. I just was a sponge all last year, just listening to everyone.
Yeah, we're going to take a break, and you've heard a lot of good answers to great questions, and we got some more coming up after this commercial break.
Remember when you picked up a car key at the local hardware store? Then they said the car dealer was your only choice. Now there's eKeys for Cars, the fast, affordable solution to your car key and remote needs. Spare or a repair, you'll be serviced by eKeys trained technicians while you wait. And yes, eKeys still handles emergencies. But why wait? eKeys for Cars. Trust them with all your car key related needs.
Okay, welcome back to Mainely Motorsports, and the guy that I still believe, and we argue about it all the time, I think he won it in 96. They just never gave him the trophy and the check, and that's Scott Mulkern. And I do still believe you won that race. That was one of those races that, at the end of it, nobody knew what was going on, and, you know, you were ninth, but I still believe you won it. But then, in 2006, you finished fourth. You know, that's pretty close. I know, talking during the offseason, if you'd have known what the trophies were, you might have turned Sammy Sessions for third just to get that trophy.
I was trying to catch him. I remember that, right?
How often, as you get older in your career, do you look back on those two races that you were really close, that what you could have done different in that race to put yourself in position to win?
Those don't bother me. It's the one where I got in with Kurt Busch. That one bothers me. That car, that was the best car I had there ever, I think.
So you went to Car Wars with?
No, but I was done anyway. The radiator was—I didn't have any water left in the radiator, and I didn't know at that time when I got into that. That was my best
one. That was your best one?
Yeah.
But the best car that you probably brought to Oxford was the day the three wide pass. You know, it wasn't the 250, but going around Cassius and Joey with the hand out the window and screaming at the top of your lungs, right? I mean. Would you take the lead in the 250 that way too, or would you be a little more conservative?
It just happened that way. That was a good car that day too, but I mean, it's hard to say. It's like Brian was saying. A lot of times you end up out of it for some reason, and you're like, you really had a good car, you know. I mean, I don't know. What was your question?
That's why you're here.
Travis, I remember the first time after you won the Oxford 250, we talked and you were back at the family store, and I remember you telling me people were coming up buying newspapers with your face on the front of it. How cool has that been, sort of being like a small town hero there? I mean, being able to sort of represent the town and then also the support you get from that community.
Yeah, it was great. Like you said, in 2013, right after the race, you know, after texting and everything, we went straight home, and at 7 o'clock the next morning, I was pumping gas for this old lady. So sent me back to reality in a hurry. And then last year, you know, we won it again, and I took the time. I had a ton of fans from the town that came, and so I hung out with them after the race, and we had a good time. Let's put it that way. And this year, I don't care what my father says. The race car is bringing in some business because I got a ton of people coming in. They're all coming to the race, and they're all coming a week early. They're all excited, so it's gonna be a fun week.
So is he gonna offer sponsorship for this race? Or?
I have to beg it for him now.
You're gonna beg him. Now, Garrett, you heard him talk to Kyle earlier about his outlaw career. 4 years ago, you'd have been wrapping up your Thursday Thunder career. 4 years later, you're rolling into the biggest one-day short track race in the country with the label of a legitimate threat to win this race. Race that Ricky Craven's won, Kyle Busch has won, Havoc, the Rose, the Dions. You know, do you ever have to stop and pinch yourself and, you know, kind of keep yourself grounded and, like, you know, hey, it's just a race?
Yeah, no, absolutely. I started out 15 in the Thursday Thunder at Beech Ridge, and I remember just my goal in racing was to be in the Oxford 250. But and now that I look at it and see we have a legitimate chance at qualifying and stuff like that, then it definitely makes me look more towards other things.
Brian, I think it was, I don't want to say too many years, but I think it was 11 years or 7 years since you got your first pass win, and then you sort of got the monkey off your back at Beech Ridge. How much confidence did that win in itself give you? I mean, since then, you were fast at Beech Ridge before the motor issue. You won Oxford. Just how much confidence do you have right now after you got the monkey off your back?
I have a lot. I definitely have a different mentality going into every race now since then. I had that cloud hanging over my head for a while. Can I do this? Or are we ever going to get, the car just to fall the right way and, get through the thing? I definitely have 110% more confidence in the car when I'm in the race and, should I make that move or not? And I think I'm a lot calmer than I was a couple of years ago. Even when we do have a good car, I don't totally screw it up before the race is over. So I think it's helped us out a lot.
What would this 250 win mean to you, Brian Kruzik, the racer?
I don't think I can put it in words. To be honest with you, I almost gave it up last season at the end of the year here. Really haven't had a lot of money behind us forever. My whole racing career, I've always done out of pocket myself. Bought secondhand stuff. I've never invested in new stuff. We bought some engines, but every other car I've had has been something we've scrapped together from somebody or borrowed or done something with. And I personally put everything I had into it this year and went ahead and purchased a new car and did everything we could do just to make sure. I wanted to make sure I wasn't just doing it for the last couple of years here, trying to flounder around. And I think I can do it. And I feel 100% positive I can get the job done if we have the right scenario. The draw is going to be the biggest thing. So I've experienced that, pulling a good chip and pulling almost the last chip out of the bag. So I think we'll be pretty good, though.
Gary, you just have a handful of past North starts on your resume, but you've shown speed in pretty much all of them so far. Going into the Oxford 250, is it a realistic goal of yours to go in and win that race, or what is your mindset entering the race as far as expectations go?
My realistic goal is to qualify and just to finish the race and have the car in one piece for our championship battle at Beech Ridge the following weekend after.
Now, Travis, everybody tells you this race is so hard to win. You've won it twice. But let's think about the guys that haven't won this race. Kelly Moore, Dale Shaw, Jeff Taylor, Johnny Clark, I mean, there was, 3 or 4 years ago when we did the hell of a good up at the Augusta show, they were all in the top 10 as far as top 10 racers of the last 25 years. None of them ever won the 250. So, does that even make it even that more special that, it isn't only who's won it, it's as big a list of who hasn't won it?
Yeah, the list of the guys who haven't won it is incredible. And, it's just, it's different situations, I mean, we had a couple situations last year. The year before that just put us in the right position, I mean, we've had good cars, obviously. You got to have good cars, obviously, but you got to set yourself up so that you're in the right position at the end of that race. And yeah, I mean, it's a tough race to win, that's for sure.
Scott, you mentioned that you're more relaxed as the years go on, but are you more or less motivated to go out and get that win? After Steve mentioned the couple times you've come up just short, had chances to win, does that make you even more motivated going into to one of your limited starts this year?
Yeah, I've always been motivated racing, but I think nowadays I'm not quite as motivated during the week. But when I get there, I give 110%. I mean, I'm real, real competitive, and so I'm focused when I'm there at the track.
Racing there every week, Kyle, do you feel like you get a little home court advantage? The characteristics of the track, some of the other stuff that goes on, and maybe you don't have that big push of fans because they see you there every week.
Yeah, I think it definitely helps. keeping the car consistent. I think it helped Jeremy last year running there weekly for the 250. So I hope that it helps us, that's for sure. And back to the provisional, that's the whole point of running weekly there, is to win the championship and to have a provisional come to 250.
Jeremy, we mentioned the success of the race cars that you have underneath you right now, but do you feel as though you've progressed as even a driver this year, or is it the race cars?
Well, I don't know. I never really had anything any good. I mean, we've raced for a long time, and I had all right cars, but we just never had the tire money to do it consistently and figure out the tire program and making sure everything sizes out right and figuring out bleeders and just stuff that I always had okay cars, but they were missing a few pieces that really held shocks and stuff that I've slowly amassed over time that have really helped this year. It's like finally we have all the pieces together, and it shows. I think it's the car. I don't know that I've really changed much driving wise, but who knows.
All right, we're going to take a break, and we know this 30 or 40.
Hi, this is Scott from Scott's Recreation. You don't have to wait until camping season is over to get your best price of the season on a new used camper. We're having our end-of-season pricing sale now. Get your best deal of the season while the best part of camping season is still here. Plus, we take most anything on trade that we don't have to feed. No money down financing with some of the best rates we've seen in years. See our inventory online with pictures and prices. Find us, like us on Facebook.
Scott's Recreation, Turner and Manchester, Maine.
Mainely Motorsports, brought to you by
Four Seasons Synthetic. See them for all your AMSOIL product needs. Town Fair Tire, with six locations in Maine: Auburn, Augusta, Bangor, Biddeford, South Portland, and Topsom. Awards and recognition, your number one source in New England for all of your award needs.
Now, Jeremy, you talked about your team being such a family-oriented team. Obviously, we know what it would mean to Jeremy Davis, but I in particular want to know what this win would mean to your father, Bob Cotton, who raced on the dirt at Beechridge against Scott Mulkern years ago. I mean, your grandfather, how big would it be to have him meet you in victory lane?
Oh, it's huge. I mean, we've been doing it, the whole family's been doing it forever, and it'd probably mean more to all of them than to me, really. I mean, I'm going to try to look at it as just another race, I guess, another race at Oxford, just like I ran every weekend last year. So I don't want to let it get to me too bad, but it would mean a lot.
Kyle, you have a few guys here who you'll be racing with on Sunday, August 30th, trying to get into the Oxford 250, but there's some people not here who maybe are even more intimidating to race next to, and that's your girlfriend, Vanna Brackett, Tim, and TJ. What's it like racing around those people? I mean, is it tougher on you? I mean, trying to avoid getting into them, is it more stressful?
It is. I get that question asked a lot. There were a couple nights this summer that me and Vanna went home not talking to each other. Mostly her fault, for sure. it's been easy racing against CJ and Tim. I mean, it's me and Tim have been going for the championship the second half of the season, And it's been all right. Mostly it's tough around Van. I want to give her breaks, and she wants to give me breaks. But at the same time, we have to remember that we're out there racing for our own team. And there was one night, we ran side by side for about 15, 20 laps, and you could probably fit two cars in between us. She was going way out wide, I was keeping it on the curb, and the leaders were pulling away. And finally, I just realized that I need to start running my own race, and I got by her. And that was the rest of that race, but that's the only hard part. It'll be interesting, like, for a transfer spot.
That's what I was just going to ask. I mean, you mentioned you'd give her a break, but if there's a transfer spot into the Oxford 250 on the line, I mean, how many breaks are you going to give her?
Not many.
Yeah, there's other girlfriends.
Yeah, exactly.
Now, Scott, take the day, you show up, you've got in your head set, you've got your plan. Then you watch practice, you realize you're 35th on the track. You know, everybody else is blistering off speed. You're not, do you stray from what your plan is, or do you just say, you know what, I'm here to run my deal, I know what we got to do, and we're good?
Well, if you're 35th, I wouldn't be too happy. I think I'd be doing something, yeah. So, yeah, you hate to watch the time sheets. It all depends, you know what you're doing with your tires. If you got new tires on there, or old tires, and you got to got to weigh that out. So, but yeah, no, if I was 35th, Springs would be flying.
Travis, you obviously have a lot of momentum going into this race based upon your results in the past two Oxford 250s in itself. But as far as this season, how confident are you going in with how your program has been and how you've run going into the Oxford 250?
I'm very confident. We got the same car, same crew. Our results really aren't showing. I mean, we've drawn last every week. We started 17th, 18th, 19th, 24th, 36th. I mean, we're just starting deep in the field. And we're getting the top five almost every week. Just at the end, just little stuff's happening, you know. So, but we had a real good car last race. I mean, we started 24th, and we got to 6th in 80 laps, you know. And I was really happy with the car. That's probably the best car I've had during the day there. Our car gets better once the sun sets usually. So I mean, my guys are excited. We're all excited. We're going to do our best, you know.
Now, Garrett, you're a rookie at Beechridge. You got two races left to go. You're in a tight point battle. You know, everybody knows what that NASCAR money is all about, what the banquet's all about. Was there ever any talk of like, you know, yeah, we want to go to the 250, but maybe we really ought to rethink this? Or was it game on, it's 250 no matter what?
We had a race car, I might as well race it, I guess. That's our motto. And just whatever happens, happens. It's meant to be, so take it as it comes.
Yeah, now will you race the night before the 250 any different than you have every other race at Beechridge? Because I know a couple weeks ago, I saw you the most aggressive I've ever seen you. And when I say aggressive, I wasn't saying moving people or anything, but you weren't passively racing. You were, if there was a hole, you were taking it. Whereas in early in the year, you were kind of like, maybe I'll wait. So your aggressiveness has picked up as the end of the season's coming.
Yeah, no, absolutely. Yeah, we definitely worked on the car more, and it seems to be better. So I'm just going to try to finish every race, and whatever will play out, I guess.
Ryan, you mentioned in past Oxford 250s, you've had some mechanical issues and whatnot, and not only 250s, but other races at Oxford. How much more does that make you focus on preparation for 250 laps? Not even 250 laps, throughout the whole weekend. How much do you focus on preparation to make sure that car can first get through a 250 laps and then be able to win?
Well, it's probably the first time I've ever started 2 weeks before a race to prep the car. Generally, we start the night before the race on average. It seems like, I don't know, I gotta thank my crew chief, Miles Chipman, and my guys at the shop. Those guys have been key this year for us, especially in the flat track races and stuff. Those guys, they've just been doing it at the shop, and we had some mechanical stuff, but I think it's, you know, it's just been luck on that stuff. So I think we've been there with it, and I'm happy to go into it.
Well, Leah, you've heard from them what it's going to take to win it, what the preparation, all of it. We're going to take a break. When we come back, you're going to hear who they think.
Race fans, it's finally here. Time for the biggest short track race in the country. It's the 42nd annual AIM Recycling Oxford 250 presented by Kenny Upole. Friday, August 28th through Sunday, August 30th at the legendary Oxford Plains Speedway. Bring the family out for the entire weekend to see the best short trackers in North America. See the Valenti Modifieds in action Saturday night, August 29th, and then Sunday afternoon, August 30th. It's the granddaddy of them all. The 42nd annual Oxford 250. Oxford Plains Speedway is located just off Route 26 in Oxford. For more info, go to oxfordplains.com.
I just bowled a perfect game. I'm going to Chicago Dogs.
I just got a hole in one. I'm going to Chicago Dogs.
You got a lays on your report card. We're going to Chicago Dogs.
Chicago Dogs, voted the state's best hot dog. Bring the entire family and try one of our one dozen dog choices, hand-cut fries, cheesesteak, sausages, and a whole lot more. Chicago Dogs, you know you want one.
All right, now we're going to hear who they think. And obviously there's 30, 40 guys, and you always got the sneak attack. And I was looking at the results over the past few years, and if you want to look at a 250 that, like, and go, really? Go back and look at 2007. Granted, they were the ACT late models, but the top 10 list was like, where did they come? Who are they? Where are they now? I mean, really.
Roger Brown.
Yeah, Roger Brown, Dale Averill. I mean, Avery. I mean, you know, some of them not even in the sport anymore. So, but every one of these guys up here capable of winning that race, plus 30 or 40 others. And I think what's happened this year with the Brian Cruzettes, the Garrett Halls, Jeremy Davis, these guys, these aren't the household names, and they're winning races, they're running up front, is giving other guys that legitimate shot that they think that, you know, we can win this race. Not only qualify, we can win this race. So now we want to hear who they think, other than himself, could win this or is going to win this race. So, Brian, you don't win the race Sunday. Who do you think standing in victory lane at the end of the day?
Probably going to have to say probably the 73 of Dorian. He seems to step up in the bigger races here, and he's had some good runs here the last couple of years. He's already got some money in his pocket from this year, and I think he can get it done.
Well, sometimes they say you got to lose one to win one. And you talk to Joey, he thinks he's lost the last two.
Yeah.
Travis has won the last two. He thinks he's lost the last two. So you're absolutely right.
Yeah.
How about you, Garrett Hall?
I was going to choose the 73, but... you know, we have all of the Southern cars coming down, and the 51, Christopher Bell, and the Kyle Busch car is probably going to be really tough.
Yeah, and that team's been to victory lane there before. So, yeah, the team's no stranger, and... You know, he gets it done.
He is a little nervous about this race, though. He's the flat track, the heat races. We talked when we did a story on Speed 51, and he doesn't like the heat races. He didn't like it at Loudon. And so I think, I don't know. I mean, I don't know. I don't want to say he's going to struggle, but I think it could be a lot tougher for him. I know he's in better equipment, but I think it could be a difficult task for him to come up and win.
Yeah, you're right. Okay, Travis, if you can't three-peat and be like Ralph, who's that? Scott Mulkern's idol, by the way.
Yeah, Ronnie too.
Ronnie too. Who wins? Who breaks your winning streak?
If I have to pick one, Mike Rowe. That guy just never gives up. If he's running 9th, he wants to be 8th. If he's running 24th, he wants to be 23rd. He just seems to amaze me.
Is he the last guy you want to look up in the mirror and see on your bumper with two?
For sure. For sure. Because he's gonna go through me. Gonna want that.
So is that the point where you say to the crew chief, do we settle for second place money or do we
try to hold him off?
Oh
no, we're gonna block all we can.
We're gonna hold him off.
Probably get spun, but
yeah. Oh yeah,
that's race.
Well, you've heard Johnny in the past, you know, because of a confrontation him and Mike had earlier in 2005, he looked in the mirror and so it was Mike and his whole demeanor and the way he drove that last 15 laps of that race, he bounced it off the curb and basically gave it to Mike. So how about you, Scott? I mean,
I'm amazed how many really, truly could win the race. It's a lot different than it used to be, you know. But I'll go with somebody. I'm gonna pick Garrett. He's that'd be a big upset. But I got to watch him at Oxford and Beechridge, and I'm impressed with this kid. And, he really had a good car there at Oxford, and the way he gets around there, I wouldn't rule him out at all. So.
Yeah. Now, Kyle, how much bragging rights would that be for you to win that race, you know what I mean? And, you know, not only in the house, in the garage, everywhere, you know, but it's possible.
It's very possible. The last local driver to win it was Jeremy Wharf. And, of course, the family. I don't know how many years Tim's been trying, but it'd be pretty cool if I could get it. But if I had to pick anyone, it would be a local driver. It would be Sean Knight. He led some laps in the spring, the 150. He finished third at the Pro Series 125 at Beechridge. He was running up front, blowing up in the 150 on August 2nd. And he's been on fire lately, weekly. So he's definitely my pick.
Yeah, I talked to him, you know, this week, and that was one of the things that he talked about was his maintenance program, you know, double checking, triple checking, because that's been his gremlin this year. And he's got three wins there. So,
yeah, exactly.
Yeah, he's definitely fast. I mean, yeah. And so, yeah. And
if he can learn to keep his tires on it, and his fenders, he'll be there at the end.
All right, Jeremy. I mean, we've narrowed it down to four guys, but you can't win it. You don't win it. Who do you think at the end of the day is standing in victory lane?
Well, I don't know. There's a couple ways I can answer that. Obviously, I want to see any of the Dale Shaw race cars win. I don't really care which one. Any of them would be great. But there's one guy I've always wanted to see win, and. He's a good friend of mine. I don't even know if he's going to run or not, but I want to see Alan Wilson win the Oxford 250 someday.
Yeah, and had it not been for a rear end and a 250-lap race, not 235 or 40, he would have already won that. And, you know, I know Alan, I saw that they weren't sure that they were running, but, you know, as that race gets closer, that's when people reach in their pocket. And you know, a lot of those teams that I've seen it on Facebook and the social media, looking for that extra help for a tire or two. And, you know, a guy like Alan, I mean, he's the story of that race, you know. I mean, many years as he goes and, you know, he just tries to compete. So, I mean, all great choices. Each one of you is a great choice. And I want to thank every one of you for showing up and helping us put this 250 pre-race show together. Are you going to release who you think is going to win it, or are you going to hold off?
I think I'm going to have to hold off. In my mind, I know who I think it's one of some guys picked.
Really?
Yeah. I don't think I can release it yet, though.
Who would you like to see win it?
Who would I like to see win it?
Not who you think win it. If you could, like, he'd like to see out, who would you like to see win it?
There's two guys that I would like to see win it. I think he's running it. Jeff Taylor, just because he's tried for so long, had so much success at Oxford, but hasn't won a 250. And Tim Brackett, those two Oxford guys. I grew up at Oxford in the grandstand, so I've watched them. And I think it'd be pretty cool to watch one of those guys win it.
Well, I'm thinking from a business standpoint, because hopefully this isn't the last time we talk, guys, because Travis knows what happens after. We get to sit on the set of Mainely Motorsports. And that's when it hit me the year Joey Pohl won the race, that how cool it is that, you know, 15 minutes after the biggest win of your career, I'm sitting there with a guy that, and talking about the other stuff, not only what it took to win the race. And so if you're one of the top three, that's what's going to happen at the end of the night before you go home. But I'll tell you who I'd love to see win it, because I think it would be the best interview ever, is the Colonel. Because I've had him on my show a couple times, and people say to me, you got to have him more often. Because, so can you imagine, I've had him just in a regular day. Can you imagine having him on the show after the Oxford 250 win?
Yeah, that would definitely be entertaining, that's for sure.
Would it be entertaining, Scott?
Yeah, I promise.
Would it be Brad Keselowski winning the championship entertaining, or even bigger than that?
I don't remember that. What happened there? I don't know.
Yeah. All right. But like I said, I want to thank you guys again, and good luck to all of you as you roll into Oxford this weekend for the biggest one-day short track race in the country. And thank you, Brandon, for all your help.
It's a good time. Same to all these drivers, as you said. Glad they could join us, and all of them have a good chance of winning the Oxford 250. It's just wide open, so really excited.
Yeah, it is. Single night, I could tell you a thing about taking your time. It's making me nervous, yeah. One step at a time, don't be living on the line. I don't need a friend, I got more than on my mind. Sunshine in my brain, making everyone complain. There you go in the heart, don't be being so strange. Think I'm losing it, baby, where have you been? Everybody says that you're moving again. Taking your time, it's making me.